أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله أوله بلا أول كان قبل وآخره بلا آخر يكون بعده الذي قصرت عن رؤيته أبصار الناظرين وأجازت عن نعته أوهام الواسفين ثم الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا حبيبنا وطبيب نفوسنا أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين بالقاسم المصطفى محمد وعليه الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين ولعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم وغاصبي حقوقهم ومنكري فزائلهم أجمعين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد عظم الله أجورنا وأجوركم بمصابنا الإمام الكاظم عليه السلام والسلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. Our condolences to the Imam of our time, to the lovers of Ahl Bayt alayhi salam, upon the shahadat of our seventh Imam, Imam Musa Kazim alayhi salam. Imam Kazim alayhi salam was about 20 years of age when he became an Imam at the shahadat of our sixth Imam. The Imam faced four different Khulafai Abbasi. After he becomes the Imam, as you are aware, that the Umayyads were crumbled basically after the Shahadat of Imam Hussein, and they managed to keep themselves in power till the fifth Imam. And during the sixth Imam, it was a complete transformation that took place. And the Abbasiyun apparently were known to be the Khulafa of the time, and they were worse, according to many of the historians, in terms of their atrocities against the Imams and against the followers. The seventh Imam was imprisoned for about 14 years of his life. He was continuously in prison, and particularly for those who have gone to Iraq have got an opportunity to really see the amount of prison and the intensity and how cruel these prisons were, where a person do not even have space to stand straight even. So therefore, the Imam, in terms of being imprisonment for about 14 years, and eventually he attained martyrdom. What we find in regards to this period is that as the Abbasis came to power right after the Umayyun, they were very lenient to begin with. But during the seventh Imam period, it was pressure upon the Shias. Harun Rashid was the Khalifa. And right after that, we also find a bit of leniency during the time of the eighth Imam, where the Ma'mun seems to be more sort of entertainment and entertaining and engaging in terms of sciences and knowledge. At the time of the seventh Imam, it was once again, the pressure was on, but what we find is Imam managed to develop the network amongst the Shias. And one of the companion of the sixth Imam, which was also the companion of the seventh Imam, Ali ibn Yaqdin, he was planted in the ministry of Harun Rashid. And through him, he helped many of the followers of Ahl Bayt alayhi salam, through Ali ibn Yaqdin. And he has taught him in terms of different ahkam and fiqh, by which he was able to do taqiyya amongst the khulafa. And he was extensively helpful towards the followers of Ahl Bayt alayhi salam. The silent detestment towards the Khulafa is clearly seen by the seventh Imam through one of the other companion who used to rent out camels. And as he has rented out camel to Harun Rashid once when he went for Hajj, thinking that it is an act of a good act or a work, where the seventh Imam pointed out to that he is not really happy and disappointed with him because he has rented out the camel, expecting that him to be alive and return the camel to the owner, basically. And here the seventh Imam expressed that you expected, didn't you expect it, that he will return the camels to you so that he lives for a longer period. And as you know that the wilayat, as you know that the hukumat or the imamat belongs to me. And he said, yes, I do. So therefore you are expecting that he will return his camels back. You are expecting that he will live for a longer period. This itself is considered against the norm of wilayat. It's considered against not being in support of that imamat and of that wilayat. We find many traditions in regards to how imam intellectually emphasize and developed the followers of Ahlul Bayt, particularly through Ali ibn Yaqdi. When we look at, there's a very famous tradition in regards to Aql, which comes from the seventh Imam, where he points out to that the intellects are of two kinds. One is an intellect which is within, and the other which is outside, which is manifested in the form of the Prophet, which is considered as a hujjat, as a proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I just want to emphasize here in regards to these two and the relationship between the intellect which is within and the intellect which is outside, with the salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his hikmat have planned the guidance of the creation, as the Quran clearly says, Hudan lil muttaqeen. The Quran is the guide for those who are pious, through the prophets. And the Imam is saying that the Anbiya, the prophets, are considered as a hujjat. And hujjat, as we know, that which is outside, which is a proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their words and their commands are considered to be the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it should be implemented and practiced. Now, the Imam says that there is another hujjat which is within you, which is considered as the aql. Now, through the guidance of the aql, a person comes to the understanding of the hujjat or of the intellect which is outside. So whatsoever the prophets are supposed to be delivered, it is intact with the intellect of insan. It's intact with the aql of insan. Now, the intellect which is within does and plays its own role, and this is where we tend to see that the scholars consider intellect as one of the divine proofs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to prove the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, such as you have the aql, you know, you have the consensus, you have the sunnah, you have the Quran, and these are the four proofs or principle upon which the scholars base their verdict upon. So therefore, the intellect that is within oneself is considered as one of the proofs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just as the intellect which is outside, or the hujjat which is outside, which is the prophet and the imams. Now, many a times, we tend to come to a different understanding or a confusing understanding in regards to many of the sayings or the verses of the Quran that exist. Now, we tend to utilize our untrained intellect in order to deduct or in order to understand some of the teachings of the Imam or some of the verses of the Quran. And this is where we tend to feel like there is supposed to be a contradiction in terms of what my aql is saying, what my intellect is saying in relation to these verses of the Quran or in relation to the hadiths of the Imams and the Prophets. Now, When we look at the traditions, we find how aql have been defined by the imams themselves. They say that aql is subservient. Aql is something that is in full servitude to the verses of the Quran and to the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam. So therefore, whenever a sort of understanding or a personal understanding of my intellect, which could be based on certain deductions, maybe on the norm, or maybe what I think to be sort of common sense, if that contradicts with the zahir or with the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, that should be kept aside. Because in human intellect doesn't have the capacity to fully comprehend the verses of the Quran, the meaning of the Quran, and the sayings of the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, and the teachings of the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam. Why do I say that? Is because the ahkam that we have in the Quran, many a times we think it is because, that we want to create a harmony amongst the society, so we have such and such law in the Quran. That there should be harmony, that there should be justice in the society, in the community. Because of that, this verse or this law is there. However, if that is sort of deteriorates, or if that doesn't exist in the society, then we are no longer in use of this verse, or we are in no longer use of that hadith or that law from the Imam Masum. That is not the case. An example. For example, many people think that hijab, for instance, is particularly in order to balance, or in order to create the harmony, in order that men be protected from the sins, the woman should be covered outside. Yes, on a level, one could accept that. However, if a person comes and inquires and mentions that, okay, what if one is in fully control, and because of this fully being control of his nafs, and he has no sort of attraction, or what seems to be attractive in a given time, it is no longer attractive anymore, then does the law still exist or not? Of course, the hijab law, or other laws that we sort of see within the Quran or in the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, the possibility of that exists, that it is for the harmony, but at the same time, it is for that personal growth as well. Because there are two types of sort of perfection. One is perfection of the self, and the other is the perfection of the community and of the jamia and of the society as well. When the society is intact and perfect, automatically the insan, automatically the individual will also become perfect because of the help of the society. If there is no sins in the society, if the society is away from corruption, automatically, even if I'm a corrupt person, somehow I will be shy enough to carry out my corruptive acts within the society, because the society is not corrupt. So therefore, the acts that exist, which is in the Quran and the Sunnah and the Hadith, they are on different levels and on different dimension. Yes, on the societal level, on the ijtimai level, in order to make the society perfect, at the same time in order to make the self and myself perfect as well. If we just take this law of hijab, for instance, it is for the society, yes, no doubt, but at the same time, it is something very personal to that very intrinsic nature of femininity, of being a female, that it is very much required for her perfection, to really cover herself in order that she reach kamal. Many a times we tend to see the law purely on the basis of society, or purely on the basis that we... purely on the basis that it is only on the, you know, horizontal or dunyavi or worldly level, rather than something that is vertical, something that is metaphysical, something that is spiritual as well. Every ahkam that exists within the Quran and within the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, it has two categories. One is the category that it gives and provides a community, a society, to reach perfection and kamal, and insan at the same time. And the other is that spiritual reality that it contains within it. By practicing of it, by implementation of it, you know, then the soul reaches perfection. And this is the very underlying fact of spiritual wayfaring, where a person is advised to act, and a person is advised to act on the wajibat, a person is asked to avoid the muharramat, and if be possible to perform the mustahabbat. You know, this is the foundation of spiritual wayfaring. You go to anybody. You know, I remember that people used to come to Agha Bahjat and say that we want you to give us something that is very unique in terms of the practice, whereby a person recites something or carry out something by which he would have some sort of spiritual understanding or unveiling of the truth and reality. Then Agha Bahjat would always say, have you read my Risale Amaliya? Which means, have you read the Islamic practical law of mine? Then they say that, obviously nobody really reads that page after, you know, page by page. But Agha will ask that. Then he would say no. So he would say, go and read that. And then you come back to me. So this clearly points out to that the ahkam that we have, which is deducted from the Quran and from the riwayat of Ahl Bayt alayhi salam with the help of the intellect. But that intellect, when it comes to that hujjat zahiri, when it comes to that hujjat, which is the anbiya and awliya, which are outside, and the imams, then it becomes paimal. Then it limits itself. It doesn't have that sort of wing to really fly above than what they have taught us. It doesn't have that much of capacity to really understand where the imam is really trying to take us. It at that point one really have to taslim. That is why our faith and our belief is considered to be a belief of the ghaib. You know, the imams, they were not weak in terms of their sort of strength. You know, there was Imam Kazim alayhi salam in that prison. There was another person who was very much sort of scared of the prison and upset and disappointed and sad. And the Imam says that, would you like to be free? He says, yes, this was in Baghdad. Sheikh Abbas Qummi mentions this. And then, in Muntaha al-Amal. And then he says, close your eyes. His prison mate closes his eyes. He says, open your eyes. As he opens his eyes, they were in Medina. So it was very simple and easy for them to carry out these sort of miracles, because they were above this physical sort of principle or laws that exist. And having said that, they were tested according to the capacity which they had. They had that spiritual, strong sort of soul, and they were tested according to that as well. Because لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Every person is tested in accordance to his capacity. So the imams, when they were such a being, and they were tested according to their strength and capacity which they had, and they faced it. When Harun Rashid sees the imam, sees like a cloth from the top in the prison of Imam Kazim alayhi salam, he asks the soldier, the prison guard, he says, what is that cloth lying there? He said, it is not the cloth. It is Imam's Kazim alayhi salam underneath that cloth. He has become so fragile and thin that it just looked like a cloth that is there. And the prison guard says that this is his habit. After Fajr prays, he is in sajda till there is tulu'e aftab. Till the sun rises, he is just in the sajda. And he is reciting, you know, ilahi azmu min zambik, faliyahsanu afu min indika ya kareem. Which we recite in the month of Rajab, is one of the recommended dua to be recited in sajda. Ilahi azmu min dambik. Oh Allah, my sins are much, is a lot, is azim, is great, you know, min ab, from this abd. But the afu, but your forgiveness is greater than that. An imam who have reached to that perfection, but even in terms of his humility and his humbleness, in regards to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is like that. That's how he was. And we tend to find that how, in a very secretive way, in the evenings, it has been reported that without making him sort of known to others, he would attend to the needs of people. He doesn't like to be known, but he would go to the houses of people and would deliver staples and would give things without being known. And this sort of fashion or this sort of style was seen in other imams as well. That they saw the fourth imam helping the hajis, cleaning them, you know, preparing their food, joining their shoes, and all that. And then finally somebody said, who's this young lad in the caravan? They say, it's somebody recognized him, and he said that it is the fourth imam, is the son of, you know, Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Then they all came and they started, you know, respecting him. And all of a sudden he takes his bag and he leaves. He says that I came here in order to gain some sawab. Now it's no longer for me anymore, right? They like to serve without being known. So the seventh imam, we tend to find the similar sort of pattern where he served the Madinans in Medina at night, very similar to how Amirul Mu'mineen and other imams. So here an imam with that sort of fragile state, as Ma'mun says, as Harun says, when he says, what is that cloth? He says, this is the imam in sajda. So the imam Masum, who is tested in according to their capacity, in according to their understanding, and they come out in flying colors once again in giving these tests. All of these sufferings that they have gone through is that. But the point here is that, as the imam says to Ali ibn Yaqtin, that there are two hujjat. One is the hujjat al-zahiri, which is outward, which is outside, which is anbiya and the imams. And there's hujjat al-batini, which is the intellect. And through this, a person comes to a certain understanding of these two hujjat. But after a while, you know, he becomes a bit weak in order to fly more. And that is where that hujjat al-zahiri comes to aid and assist and help. Malik-e-Ashtar also kills, Amirul Mu'mineen also kills. Malik-e-Ashtar says, if I kill one more, I would have been killed more than you or equal to you. Amirul Mu'mineen says, oh Malik, when you kill people, you just kill them, your enemy whoever comes in front of you. But when I kill them, I look at the seventh generation, that if there be a Muslim, I don't kill them, I just leave them. So this is the different, this is the two different methodologies among those. Although Malik, for whom the Amirul Mu'mineen says that Malik is like Ali to the Prophet. The relationship of Malik Ashtar and Amirul Mu'mineen is like that. So even Malik to that extent, you know, weakens in terms of his calculation, in terms of his understanding. So the teachings of the Masumeen alayhim salam, they are on metaphysical, on spiritual level as well, and at the same time they are on that zahiri level, and it should be so. Why not, right? As a priority. So for us to begin with, we understand that through sort of our intellectualizing, through our inner intellect that we have, we understand that. But after a little while, it becomes sort of like very difficult for us to really comprehend and understand. And that requires that ilm-e huzuri, that requires that inner knowledge that comes about through, once again, that, you know, dedication, through where a person surrenders to the will of the imam and the imam takes. And that is one of the theological meaning of the imam, is the imam who isalul matlub, who he makes you reach the destination. That is an imam. That's the difference between Rasul and imam. Rasul, he brings the risalat and he gives, but the imam takes you and makes sure that you reach the destination. That is the imam. So the imams and the sayings and the teachings that we find in regards to the imam, and particularly where, if one really looks and investigate that very detailed hadith of intellect, is really amazing. The seventh imam, as we all know, that once he was poisoned in the grapes, and he says that the first day my body will turn red, the second day it will turn black, and the third day it will turn pale. And once it's been reported that four people came out from the prison of Baghdad and they were asked to lift something. They were called from outside, they came, they were asked to lift something. They say, it's so heavy. And they lifted and they brought it. First they put it in one of the rooms in the prison itself. And they say, what is this? It's so heavy. Then they removed the sheet. They saw the body of Musa Kazim alayhi salam, where it was already in chains, as they say. One of the imams who was poisoned and who was in chain, it was Imam Musa Kazim. کہا جاتا ہے کہ امام موسیٰ کاظم کو جب زہر دیا گیا اور جب ان کی روح پرواز کر گئی زنجیروں میں ان کا بدن جگڑا ہوا تھا شہید ہونے کے بعد زنجیروں کو کاٹا گیا ہے جب زنجیروں کو کاٹا گیا ہے امام کے جنازے کو بغداد کے پل پہ لا کر بغداد کے برج پہ لا کر رکھا گیا ہے اور پھر اس کے بعد اعلان ہوا ہے کہ آؤ دیکھو یہ شیعوں کا امام ہے اور یہ اپنی موت مرا ہے ہم نے اس نے نہیں مارا ہے لیکن امام فرماتے ہیں کہ غیب سے امام فرماتے ہیں کہ مجھے زہر دیا گیا ہے اور پھر اس کے بعد جب شیعوں نے یہ دیکھا اور اس میں سے ایک ایسی خاتون تھی جس کا نام تھا توا وہ کہتی ہے اور مد میں جو ہے امام کے شعر پڑھنے لگتی ہے اور اہل بیت علیہ السلام کے اور پھر اس کے بعد یہ خلیفہ وقت ناراضی اور ناراحت ہوتا ہے اس سے اور پھر اس کے بعد ایک کے بعد ایک شیعہ لوگ آتے ہیں اور امام کے جنازے کو امام کے جسد کو دیکھتے ہیں اور پرسا دیتے ہیں کہا گیا روایتوں میں یہ کہا گیا ہے کہ لوگ اتنے آ گئے تھے اور اتنا گل پھول پھینکنے لگے تھے کہ تمام بغداد میں پھولوں کی خوشبو ہو چکی تھی لیکن وہ جنازہ بھی تھا جو کربلا کے میدان میں جہاں پہ کہا گیا تھا کہ بغیر گور و کفن سر پہ بدن پہ سر بھی نہیں تھا اور پھر اس کے بعد امام چوتھے امام آتے ہیں اور دفناتے ہیں لیکن ہمیں وہاں پہ بھی یہ روایت ملتی ہے کہ کربلا کے میدان میں خون کی بو نہیں تھی لیکن خوشبو تھی جب پوچھا گیا امام زین العابدین سے یہ کس کی خوشبو ہے یہاں پہ امام فرماتے ہیں کہ جب جان رن میں اجازت جانے کے لیے اجازت لے کے آیا تھا اور کہنے لگا کیا تھا کہ میں کالا ہوں اور میری پسینے میں بو رہتی ہے اس لیے مجھے اجازت نہیں دے رہے ہیں میرے مولا یہاں پر امام حسین نے کہا تھا کہ تیری بدن سے ایسی خوشبو آئے گی کہ تمام کربلا کے میدان میں یہ خوشبو پھیل جائے گی امام زین العابدین فرماتے ہیں یہ وہ خوشبو ہے اور یہاں پہ ہمارے ساتویں امام کو غسل دے رہے ہیں امام رضا علیہ السلام کفن پنا رہے ہیں نماز میت پڑھی جا رہی ہے اللہ لعنۃ اللہ علی قوم الظالمین سیعلم الذین ظلموا ای منقلبین ینقلبون ماتم حسین یا حسین